Good afternoon, everyone. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to moderate this panel, and we'll get pretty much directly to our panelists. I'm going to introduce them first, and then we'll probably go in the order of Nancy, who is on your far left, and then Julie, who is on the other extreme side, and Eric, and then Carol. So Nancy Green-Saraisky is adjunct assistant professor and research associate in the Department of International and Transcultural Studies at TC. She received her PhD in comparative and international education here with a concentration in political science. Nancy began her policy career on the staff of Senator Edward Kennedy and has also worked on the Clinton presidential campaign and for the Markle Foundation and the Open Society Foundations. Her current research looks at how states use results from international large-scale assessments of education to inform policy and practice. With Oren Pismoni-Levy, she is the architect of the first national study of the opt-out movement, and she'll tell us about her research in a few minutes. Julie Zuckerman is the founding principal of Castle Bridge School in Washington Heights, a progressive PK through 5 school. Castle Bridge is distinctive in a number of ways, including its dual language instruction in English and Spanish, mixed age classrooms, and project-based learning approach. Before founding Castle Bridge, Julie taught for 21 years and served as the principal of Central Park East One School. She received a master's degree from TC in 1984 and her doctorate in 2000. Parents at Castle Bridge were a little bit ahead of the curve, and they united fairly early to boycott standardized assessments. And Julie will be telling us the story of opting out at Castle Bridge. Eric Shieh, on my left here, is one of the founding teachers of Metropolitan Expeditionary Learning School in Queens, where he teaches music to middle school students. At MELS, he's been the teacher union chapter leader and a seventh grade team leader. He's also been an assessment policy analyst for the New York City Department of Education. Eric received his EDM in curriculum and teaching from Teachers College in 2010, and he's currently a candidate for an EDD. And in between those two things, he had the misfortune of being in a course on the sociology of schools the very first time I was teaching it. Eric is also the principal violinist for the String Orchestra of Brooklyn and former assistant concertmaster of the St. Louis Philharmonic Orchestra. He'll be talking today about how the school community at MELS has confronted high-stakes standardized testing. Finally, Carol Corbett Burris is the executive director of the Network for Public Education, a national advocacy organization she's led since 2015. After retiring from a highly successful career as the principal of Southside High School in Rockville Center, New York. During her tenure at Southside, Carol was named New York State High School Principal of the Year and the New York School Administrators Association Outstanding Educator of the Year. Carol is a fellow of the National Education Policy Center and has written influential books on tracking, detracking, and Common Core learning standards. She received her doctorate in educational administration from TC in 2001. And Carol will be talking about her understandings of opting out from her dual vantage point as the leader of a national advocacy organization and as a longtime observer of Long Island, which has been one of the epicenters of opting out. So we'll start with Nancy, and each of our panelists will talk for roughly 10 minutes, and we'll have plenty of time for comments and questions from the audience after that.
Great. Thanks, Professor Pallas, and thank you all for coming this afternoon. It's really nice to see everyone. So I'm going to talk today a little bit about findings from a national survey, as Professor Pallas said, that I fielded with my colleague Oren Pismoni-Levy, who's an assistant professor in the Department of International Transcultural Studies. He's traveling, so he couldn't be here today. But before I do that, I'm going to just give a little bit of background about how we ended up taking this survey to the field. So Oren and I are both interested in social movements, and we had been watching the past several years as the press would seem to increasingly be reporting on this phenomenon of parents who were refusing to have their kids sit for federally mandated standardized testing, what we all now know of as the opt-out movement. And social movements, we thought were are pretty interesting inherently, right? They're fairly dramatic and they're not that common. But with opt-out in particular, we thought there were a couple of things that would be very interesting to focus on. So first, social movements that challenge educational institutions are obviously interesting for their potential to impact education. But we were also interested in how this social movement might give us a window into the larger issues in society at the moment. So what are the values that citizens coalesce around? Why do people cooperate? What motivates people to try and disrupt the way things are being done, business as usual? And what grievances are strong enough to compel people to participate? So our feeling was that social challenges to these social institutions really have ramifications that could be interesting. Secondly, as scholars interested in educational policy development, we were interested in the forces that mobilize to create educational policy, and also particularly the techniques that citizens use to organize and mobilize. And so it was this background that brought us to the idea of fielding a survey. So as we were thinking about this, we thought, well, what do we know about the opt-out movement? And the answer actually was not very much. In 2012, some of you might remember that Arnie Duncan was famously dismissive of reports about backlash against standardized testing as something to the effect of, this is just white suburban moms who are upset that their kids aren't as brilliant as they thought they were. I paraphrase, but it was something to that effect. And of course, that quote generated a lot of media attention. But actually, the activists' identities and their motivations were really not very well understood. There was some existing literature on the opt-out movement, but it was limited and it was a little bit conflicting. So for instance, in 2015, the EdNext public opinion poll up at Harvard found that 25% of respondents supported the general idea of opting out. That same year, the PDK Gallup poll found that close to 50% of their respondents thought parents should have the right to opt out. There was another paper by Matthew Chingos that looked specifically at New York State and found that lower performing districts seem to have slightly higher opt-out rates, but that was based on aggregated data supplied by the state and the districts. And Bennett also did a meta-analysis in 2016 that basically compared existing studies around the country, and there weren't that many of them, and his conclusion was that the opt-out rates across the U.S. were rather variable. But it was really just an overview of existing studies. So there was really pretty limited scholarly work on who was opting out and why, and no one had gone to the protesters themselves to ask them directly. And so that's what Oren and I decided to do. So our survey was focused broadly around four questions. Who opts out? How do they become involved in the movement, and what do they do? Why do people participate? And what do these participants think about education policy? And today I'm just going to focus briefly on who opts out and why. Quickly, let me just give a few technical notes about what we did. Administered an online survey using the Qualtrics interface the first quarter of last year, and we gathered a non-probability sample of adults using Facebook pages and social media opt-out networks. So these were groups that had an organized online presence. We sent them a link to the survey explaining who we were, what we were doing, asked them to post this link on their website and also to share with their organizational networks and their personal networks. In total, we had over 2,100 people respond to the survey after we accounted for some non-response in the sample. The analytical sample I'm going to be talking about today is just over 1,600 people, and they come from 47 states in the U.S., so we had a very good geographic coverage as well. We ran regression analyses on the data, controlling for a bunch of different variables that I've posted up there. I should also just mention a few limitations to the study. First of all, obviously, because we administered it online, we could only reach respondents who were online. People that were not, did not have access to the internet, could not answer the survey. There's also a sampling bias towards organizations who had an online presence, because that was the way we sampled the respondents. And of course, the results that I'm going to be sharing are based on self-reported behavior as people answering about their own practices. So that's always subject to some amount of response bias. So let me just give you four sort of headline findings. And again, this is a national sample. So the rest of the panel is going to be talking specifically about New York State. This is an overview of what we found nationally. I'll give you four headlines and then talk very briefly about each. So first of all, we found that the opt-out movement is not a broad-based people's movement. However, the opt-out movement is more than parents of kids just opting their children out of testing, and I'll talk more about that in a minute. Opt-out is also more, it's about more than just opposition to standardized testing. And finally, we found that different groups have different motivations for participation. So first of all, the opt-out movement we would not describe as a broad-based people's movement. Our typical respondent was white, married, highly educated, politically liberal, a parent whose household income was well above the national average. So you can see that over 85% of our respondents had at least a bachelor's degree or higher. About 55% of our respondents had a household income reported as over $100,000. And in terms of race and ethnicity, over 90% of our respondents identified as white. Interestingly, though, our respondents were not just parents of public school kids who would be affected by this mandated testing. So indeed, they were 61% of our respondents were public school parents. But we also had 19% of our respondents who were public school parents who, although they were involved in the movement, they did not opt their kids out. So they're answering the survey, but they're not actually sort of going all the way and refusing the tests. Additionally, we had another 2% who were parents of kids who were school age but didn't go to public school. They were either private school kids or they were homeschooled, meaning that their kids didn't have to sit for these tests, but they were involved in the movement anyway. And finally, 18% of our respondents were not parents. So these were people that were involved in education activism through the opt-out networks, but didn't have school-age children affected by standardized tests. When we asked our respondents why they were opting out, we asked them to pick their top five reasons out of a list of 16. And I apologize because it's probably a little bit hard to see this, but I'll just go through the top couple. The number one answer was, I oppose using students' performance on standardized tests to evaluate teachers. And this perhaps was not surprising because our sample was comprised actually of over 40% of people, 40% of our respondents said that they were either teachers or had friends who were involved in the education industry or were married to someone in their family or friend circle was somehow involved in education. Other top reasons were, I oppose the growing role of corporations in schools, standardized tests force teachers to teach to the test, standardized tests take away too much instructional time, and the fifth most popular reason was, I oppose the Common Core state standards. So a variety of different reasons. This might be interesting to some of you involved in opt-out network. We asked our respondents who was mobilizing them for action. How did they get involved? And so what you see here is a network analysis. The organizations that are on this chart are organizations that were coded if the respondent mentioned two organizations. And if they were co-mentioned, they're linked by a line. So the black dots on the screen are organizations that are directly part of an opt-out network. So the organizations are designed to deal specifically with opt-out, which is not surprising. So United Opt-Out is right in the center of the network, as you might anticipate. What's interesting is so many other organizations, which are the other colored dots, are also involved in the network. So organizations that have different educational agendas also got deeply involved in mobilizing participants in the movement. And then finally, we found that different groups have different reasons for participating. So here, this slide compares teachers with non-teacher respondents. And this is responses controlling for other demographics. So this is net of other effects. So there are significant differences between teachers and non-teachers. So what we see, the teachers are in red. So what we see, for instance, is teachers oppose using student performance on standardized tests significantly more than non-teachers. However, if you go to, I oppose the Common Core State Standards, teachers are actually much more supportive than non-teachers of that. So there are some significant differences between teachers and non-teachers. And finally, we did another analysis, for instance, by political ideology. And we found that differences between liberals and people who said that they were middle of the road politically weren't all that much, but liberals and conservatives were significantly different on several motivations. For instance, on forcing teachers to teach the test and on takeaway instructional time, there were not significant differences between liberals and conservatives, but on some of the others, again, if we look at the Common Core State Standards, liberals only 16% were opposed, while conservatives 45% were opposed. So we saw political leaning as a big cleavage in our respondents. I know I'm already pushing my limits on time, so those are just a few highlights. For more information, the survey, the entire report of the survey can be found online, and I'll stop there. Thanks. Yes,
it's on the TC website, I believe.
On the
TC? Yes. So now we'll turn to Julie Zuckerman.
Hi there. So I'm an elementary school principal. Our school opened 5 years ago, and our weighing into the opt-out movement as a school had to do with the rolling out of a K-2 test, and I can't remember how many, I think it was 3 years ago, might have been 4 years ago. I had been part of a network of principals that was opposed to testing, and the thing we always said was, K-2 testing is a bridge too far, forget it, it's not happening, we're not going there. And because I was in a new school, what the Department of Education and all of its genius decided was that the schools, there were 40 schools that did not have testing grades in the city. And how were they going to decide whether the teachers were competent if they couldn't see test scores? So they were going to give us this K-2 test. And I opened the box for the test, and the test was really obscene. It was for kindergartners and the test was supposed to be taken in October and then again at the end of the year. Because they recognize that kindergartners can't recognize numbers, they had little icons for the kids to point to for the question. And yet, the questions were all about numbers and reading and this kind of stuff. So one question, for instance, was count the number of stars in the diagram. It was 7 stars. And they didn't have, you didn't bubble in the number 7. So a kid might be able to count, a 5-year-old might be able to count those stars. But then they had written out 5, 6, 7. Okay, October for kindergartners. I said, okay, we're not giving this test. But I decided before pulling it myself, I would just take it to the parents. I said, here, this is what they're going to do, or this is what they expect us to do. And the parents rose up and distributed. They looked at the test. We had discussion about it, and they distributed an opt-out form. And when we got to 80%, I just canceled it. And it was at that point that the Daily News got a hold of that information. One of the things that I found was that nobody in the Department of Education, I don't know how many of you are from New York, but nobody in Tweed could tell me there was any justification behind or validity for this test. So they were all like, okay, you know, they were sort of like, we know Julie's not going to do this. That wasn't a surprise. And then they had to run it up to the state, and they wound up pulling the test from the state. What was horrifying to me was that my colleagues in the other 40 early childhood schools didn't rise up against it. It's like, oh, well, we'll just do it. It's easier, whatever. It doesn't mean anything. So that was that test. Then we got to a testing age where the kids got up to third grade. So our first year, we had 100% opt-out. That was all of 24 kids. Last year, 3 kids out of 70 kids took the test. That still seemed pretty good. This year, we're big failures. Only 25% of the kids took the test, but you know, it was still a big number for us. I think that part of what was going on this year was that parents didn't engage in the same way, and I'm not officially, you know, we have to let the parents do the speaking for us on that. And there's, in New York City, getting into middle school is a big deal. And that's why in suburban districts where you just go to the next school, it's a lot easier to opt out. But in a school like ours, which was new, we had no idea, despite my own, you know, braggadocio and arrogance, saying, oh, don't worry, we'll be able to get the kids into school. There's still reasonably a fair amount of nervousness about where the kids are going to go to middle school. So there were more people who took the test. I think now that we will begin to have a track record, we'll be able to talk that down. The big thing for the parents that they understand is that they have much more information about their kids from the regular running of the school. The kids have, the teachers write 3 or 4 page narrative evaluations on the kids. There's no information that the parents can get from the test that is really of any value. And the parents are very clear about that. The other thing that I just want to mention that is not yet really in the movement is the heavy testing that's done for students who don't speak English. And there's not I don't know what to do about that. I haven't connected yet with other principals and other educators around that. The issue for us is not, you know, how do we get the kids into school? It's all about federal funding. And the kids taking that test has to do with what funding we get into the schools. So it's just an ugly payoff, but is, I feel, the next big thing we need to do, because it does, it shuts down schools for 4 weeks, 6 weeks. The school that we're co-located with is 50% ELL kids. They have to test the kids in small groups or individually. All of the staff resources have to go into that, and that's plunked down right in the middle of the state tests as well. So spring is a hot mess.
Okay. Hi, I'm Eric Shieh. As mentioned, I'm a teacher at the Metropolitan Expeditionary Learning School. I always have to say that's not a charter school whenever I say a name like that. I'm a teacher and also the union leader at the school, and I'll speak a little bit about the participation of our union space in leading opt-out in my school. So last week I actually sat down with a few of the teachers that have been leading the opt-out work in my school and strategizing around this. And I want to begin with a quote from one of them, which might not be what you'd expect in this session. But one of the teachers said, "Opt-out really sucked this year." And so today, I actually want to give you three reasons why opt-out sucked at the Metropolitan Expeditionary Learning School this year, and compare it in some ways to last year, where it felt a lot more energetic in our school. And in thinking about the difference between these 2 years, there's a point I want to emphasize, which is that the way opt-out feels at the school matter actually ends up mattering a lot. And by that, I mean the purpose to the opting out, its communication, the way it's taken up in the different school spaces. And that matters, I believe, tremendously in our ongoing national struggle over the nature of education. Opt-out, I think, deserves reminding, is a way about speaking towards that larger conversation on education. I don't believe opt-out is an end in and of itself. And so the way opt-out looks and the way it's managed and the way it's messaged, I think, has a lot to do with the way the larger movement might turn out. But first, a few numbers for my school. So compared to Julie's school, we're a complete failure. This year, only 65 of our 350 middle school students — it's a K-12 school — but 65 out of those 350 students, which is about 19% of our students, opted out. Last year, that's compared to about 100 students, which was about 30% of our students. So on to the reasons for why it sucked this year. Reason number one is, I'd say that this year, opt-out didn't feel like something the whole school community was a part of. And that deserves a little bit of explanation, because opt-out we're used to thinking of as a parent movement. But that ignores the way I think that, at best, parents, teachers, students, administrators are always in conversation, are always in dialogue about what they think is best for kids. So Julie clearly had a role to play in the way things played out at Castlebridge. And in the same way, speaking as a teacher, opt-out has a huge impact on what kind of school we are. And so the state and the city might have this fantasy that teachers and administrators are largely playing this passive role where we collect letters and then we say, okay, you can opt out. But the best schools always, right, try to negotiate and shape policies in a way that feels coherent and purposeful to the entire community. So my school is one of those schools. We spend a lot of time as a teaching staff trying to make sense of how we negotiate a testing environment that in a lot of ways doesn't sit well with our progressive commitments. We're an interdisciplinary, project-based school, and we don't have textbooks, and we refuse to teach towards tests. So when we're talking about opt-out, where my school stands in that matters a great deal to us. So speaking towards last year's opt-out, we spent a lot of time in our union meetings kind of discussing and trying to come to consensus as a staff about where we stood in relation to the movement. We read Change the Stakes, which is a book that's come out about reasons to opt-out. We talked about individually, we shared our individual positions on it, and we finally came to a consensus, and we drafted kind of a list of agreements that would define how we as a staff messaged out opt-out and spoke about it with our parent community and with our students. And importantly, our administrators actually also supported that consensus document that our teachers came up with. So last year, there was a clear sense of purpose, a clear sense of community and solidarity. I would even say last year, there's a great deal of excitement in my school around opt-out. Our English department bought these t-shirts that said, "Change the Stakes" on it, more than a score on it. And they wore those proudly. Everyone knew what was going on. Our parents knew what was going on. Teachers volunteered to write and to teach alternative lessons to students who opted out to ensure that those who opted out would have a positive learning experience. So I think it's telling that when the moratorium happened — and for those of you who are unfamiliar, this was December 2015, but it really got messaged out to the New York City schools at the end of January 2016. New York State let out a moratorium on the use of the new Common Core tests for student promotion as well as for teacher evaluation. So right before the state test last year, in some ways they cut the legs under a lot of the organizing by saying they're no longer going to be high stakes, so you don't need to opt out. And I think it is telling for the messaging and for the purposes of our school that some parents actually at that point opted their students back into the tests. And I think that matters to me because it means that they thought carefully about why they're opting their students out. And once those reasons were given, if that was the reason a parent opted out because of things like teacher evaluation or student promotion, they said, no, my child's going to take the test now. So this year, going to 2 weeks ago when we administered the English test, I think two things happened. First, the moratorium that happened last year forced some revisiting for our staff. We asked those questions, what's the message this year? Why are we doing this? Are we just against testing? As a staff, we didn't want to just communicate a glib, like, anti-testing stance. That felt a little bit destructive and unthoughtful to us as educators. So in the early meeting of teachers this year in our union space, the cause just felt less pressing. And a second reason I think it felt less pressing this year is, to be honest, there are a lot of other pressing things that were going on this year. So as one teacher put it, quote, I have other things to think about. I need to make sure our transgender students have bathrooms and feel safe. I need to protect my immigrant students. My school is in Queens. Our union space has been consumed with just massive organizing since last November and September, and phone banking and on a variety of national issues. So we sent our parents a pretty non-committal letter reminding them they had the opportunity to opt out. Our PTA, unlike last year, wasn't really involved in networking and communicating among parents and organizing. And parents parents that were active last year just really weren't active this year. And I think that speaks a bit to the signals that some parents will read from schools. It didn't seem like our school was really gearing up for this. So some parents that last year really organized this kind of took a step back. And chances are they also had other things on their mind as well this year. So the teachers that last year, to close the loop on that, that were really excited to run the alternative spaces for students that were opting out, one of those teachers said, quote, none of us were very jazzed about doing it again this year. They didn't feel like they were representing a whole community in this, that was something that they're doing this year. So reason for opt-out sucking this year, number two, has to do with the experience of students. Last year, as I mentioned, the energy around opt-out was really palpable. And I remember very clearly this group of eighth grade girls that were really passionate about the fact they were opting out. And they were telling other students about how they're opting out because tests judged them in a way that really shouldn't matter to students. And they requested that they be allowed to show a video in our community meetings, which is when the whole grade gets together in our school to kind of talk through issues and things that are surfacing in the grade. And they asked to show this video that involved a spoken word artist talking about how, like, you're more than the test and how tests don't measure who you are and the narrowness of the tests. So there's something of a student movement going around last year that created a lot of energy in the school. This year we lost that, and there just wasn't really a passionate public group of students that were speaking about it. And in the end, to be honest, it didn't really feel like a lot of the students that opted out for a principled reason. It seemed like many of the students who opted out simply didn't want to take the tests, and which is not to diminish that rationale because the test is a wretched experience for a lot of students. But it's a different feeling for us from a school when a lot of the students are just like, oh, I didn't want to take the test, so my parents signed that letter. And that really hit home for me when one of our seventh graders, in kind of a interesting parallel situation, asked if he could give an inspirational speech to the seventh grade community meeting the week of the test. And he sent me a copy of the speech ahead of time because I'm in charge of that seventh grade community meeting. And here's an excerpt from that speech, which is a little painful. Quote, for those who opted out of the state test, although I don't get along with you the majority of the time, I also wanted to say, it's okay. I know why you or your parents or family may have opted you out of the state test. You probably weren't ready for this. You probably weren't ready. So none of us in the school, no student would have said that, I think, last year. But the discourse had dramatically changed from the course of 1 year to another. And between the years, something got lost. And for it just didn't feel educative as a movement to students. And for me as a teacher, that creates a very odd space when the participation opt-out doesn't feel like something that we can learn and that we can grow from. And so my third point, my last point is about the capacity of schools to opt-out well, as I think about what's changed between last year and this year. The first thing for me that has to do with an organized parent community, talking to colleagues at other schools that have opted out tremendous numbers of students, it seems like that a large number of parents have organized the opt-out, more so, and I think our school, the impetus began with the school teachers and with our administrators. So I think, and I was talking to Julie earlier, I personally think that it's harder to organize a parent community in a secondary level, more than an elementary school level, but regardless, I think for us, the fact that our opt-out fell so quickly in the second year has a lot to do with the fact that parents read signs from the school, and we didn't have that kind of close connection or a sense of empowering our activist parents that second year. I've also commiserated with a number of other union chapter leaders about policy activism in schools. And one thing we frequently talk about is how piecemeal organizing can feel in schools. When teachers at my school get really revved up about something, we're very good about naming actions and getting together to do them. But that often feels very driven by crises, and it's never as sustained as I'd like. People often blame that on the fact that teachers have such immense workloads, and that's certainly true. I also think it has to do with the fact that teachers are always positioned as receivers of policies. We're called policy implementers, never policy makers, by researchers. So I once had a colleague tell me when I suggested that teachers are policymakers too, that he was like, no, teachers aren't policymakers. Teachers are people. Policymakers are not people. People are the people that get acted on by policy. And I think that's actually a very scary thought when a teacher's articulating that. And so my final thought is that, on the other hand, there are some things that are going for my school that I think are worth mentioning. I think, very importantly, our progressive curricular commitments matter. I believe how a school approaches curriculum matters a lot to how teachers are positioned in their ability to stand up to standardized testing. It gives them a place to speak, a place to stand from. My school also benefits from a union space that spends a lot of time working on organizing and doing policy education, which I think a lot of schools have a hard time with using a teacher organizing space like that. And finally, we benefit from a supportive administration that's always been willing to kind of buffer a lot of our teacher activism from some of the harder consequences that might come down to us. So thankfully, though, opt-out is not over yet for this year. We've got one of the tests done 2 weeks ago, and the math state tests are still coming up. So with some reflection, I think we do have some opportunities this year to continue doing the work of building towards a more educative opt-out. Thank you.
Well, there's always a lot of focus on New York State when we talk about opt-out. And opt-out didn't start in New York State. In fact, the roots of it were probably further out west in Colorado. However, New York State is unique in that the numbers and proportions of students opting out is really so extraordinary. So we're on our third year at about 20%. It's probably going to be a little bit lower this year, but not that low. So the question then is why? Why New York? Why of all of the places in the United States did opt-out stick in New York? And so I thought that what I would do with you today is to just give you sort of a peek into the history of the opt-out movement in New York State that I think will give you some insight. Now, I'm looking at some of you with little smiles on your face because you probably remember this video. Could somebody turn that? Do I have to turn that on? Okay.
Our tech person's going to get it going.
Yeah, just going to see a tiny, tiny bit of it.
Some people like to climb mountains. I like to build planes in the air.
Okay. Now, when you go home, YouTube the whole video, and what you'll see at the end is a Heineken commercial logo. Now, what does that have to do with opt-out? Well, when I first blogged about that video in the Washington Post as a good description of New York State school reform, a lot of my friends thought that I was incredibly clever. I assure you I'm not that clever. But the New York State Education Department was. The video of the plane being built in the air was shown at the training for Race to the Top when they used to have those little turnkey trainers, if you remember from a couple of years back. Apparently, the New York State Education Department thought it was very funny. This is how they were describing their reforms, as a plane being built in the air. And so what happened was when the training came back to the field with the trainers, the people that were trained up in SED started using that video to train. And I was one of the principals that were in the room in Nassau-Bosse's, and I saw it. And while State Education Department may have thought it was funny. I did not. And neither did a lot of principals and teachers on Long Island. And I assure you that parents didn't think that it was too amusing as well. What happened is it almost became symbolic, this particular video, about what was happening at the time in New York State, referring to New York State's Common Core reforms, especially testing. The video made it clear that everything that they were doing, from the teacher evaluation system to the new test, was really being built on the fly. So, although most states at the time had not begun Common Core testing, in New York, if you were around then, we were being told that this was an emergency, right? The phrases that were being used at the time was that we had to jump into the deep end of the pool. Now, of course, it's kids on the diving board, but this is an actual quote that was in the paper from then Chancellor Merrill Tisch. And Dennis Wolcott, who was the chancellor in New York City, said we just needed to rip off the Band-Aids. And we were obligated to rip off the Band-Aids. So we didn't have time to do anything right. We just had to get it done in the fierce urgency of now. And before that first test, that first Common Core test, was taken out of the bubble wrap, before that first number two pencil was sharpened, then Commissioner King told us what the failure rate was going to be. He said, he predicted, that only 30% of all New York State youngsters were going to pass the test. So the question is, well, because it actually turned out that way, how did he know that? Well, he knew it because he's the guy who sets the cut score. And he wanted to show whether or not, with the test results, whether 8 or 9 year olds are on the path to college readiness. So they had to kind of figure out, well, what does college readiness mean? Now, the College Board says that if students get a combined score of 1550 on the SATs, that is a prediction that they're actually ready for college, along with other factors that are far more important than the SATs, like what courses they took and how well they actually did in those courses. But that data was not good enough for the State Education Department, and so the Board of Regents did its own study. And you can see the results of that study up there. And what the study said was that in order to have a good chance of getting a B minus in college math, just a B minus introductory college math, that a score of about 710 was needed. Now that's a score that about 5% of all test takers on the SAT get. Now, a reasonable person, like, you know, holy Doogie Howser, right, would sit back and say there's something probably wrong with this study if they believe that's the score you need to get a B minus on the test. But rather than relook at their study and maybe question it, what they did was they just hopped over to the other column and they took the score of the 540. That was the C. They put it together with the scores on the left-hand side. They came up with a score of 1630. Which is higher than the average score of kids whose parents have a college degree. And they said, that's what's needed for college readiness. So what we're going to do is we're going to do some correlations with the test, and that's how we're going to set the cut score. Well, about 32% of the kids nationwide get that combined score on the SAT. So it's not a surprise that 30% of the kids pass those first 3-day tests. And then there were the tests themselves. Testing went up, and it went up a lot in terms of time and hours when we moved to the new tests. And you can bet your sleeveless pineapple that those tests were very hard. Kids cried. Some threw up. Some wet their pants. I mean, these were real stories. And they would almost seem to be funny, except there were kids that were going through this, and they were going through this in our schools, and we especially saw it on Long Island. You know, because when you're 8 years old, you want to do well. You don't want to let your teacher down. You don't want to let your parents down. And when they were confronted with tests that asked them, that required them to reread four different paragraphs and then deciding which one of those paragraphs is best connected to a fifth paragraph, well, that's enough to make a third grader give up. And that's just what a lot of them did. The number of students who scored below basic in the score band called 1 ballooned. That's the band where you find the kids who start the test and then they give up and they just start to guess. They were the ones that sunk in the deep end of the pool, which brings us to opt out. Because when those scores came out after that first test, New York parents were furious. But they were not furious with their schools, which is kind of what everybody, I think, intended them to be, right? Be very disappointed in your schools, sort of that Arnie Duncan remark of your schools really aren't doing a good job. Parents were not angry with their schools. They were angry with the people in Albany. They were angry with the tests. They had enough. They didn't want their children sitting for tests longer than the SAT. So beginning in October of 2013 and throughout some very, very cold winter months, New York parents flocked to forums to meet other like-minded parents and neighbors who were opting their children out of the upcoming state-mandated standardized tests for 3 to 8. Opting out became their means to express their displeasure with the tests, with the Common Core, with evaluating teachers by test scores, with the whole idea of having high stakes on the test and having to teach to the test. They were also starting to rebel against that loss of local control, where all of these things were happening to their schools, where especially in the suburban communities where the opt-out movement was really hooked, they were used to that idea of local control and having voice in schools through their school board. And so a lot of parents started to really get that message about the plane being built in the air. And they noticed, if you watch that video, that the only folks parachuting off the plane were the people who were building it. And they didn't like the idea of their kids being left inside. And so the second year of Common Core testing, around 60,000 students opted out of the test. But it did not end with 60,000. In 2013, that was the first year of the Common Core test, 5,000 kids, may have very well been kids that were just absent that day, because they weren't, or through the testing period, they really weren't logging the number of opt-outs then. Then it grew to 60,000. 2015, it grew to 240,000. That's when we started to hit the 20% mark. 2016 went up to 265,000. And there's a thought to the folks that I'm talking to in Long Island opt-out and NYSAPE who keep a close track, think it's going to drop a little bit. But while in some places it did drop, another place in Long Island, it grew, which was really remarkable this year. So it's going to be around that 20% mark again. And it's fascinating because even as we were talking before, is maybe a little bit less energy. A lot of the leaders of the opt-out movement that were doing the forums in previous years, they didn't do them this year. They were like tired, they were done. And yet, somehow this concept of opting out until the test changed got baked in to what it is that parents want and expect of their schools. So what's going to make folks opt back in, right? Because that's always the big question. Looking at it from a distance, I think first is shorter, more reasonable tests. You can't have tests that make kids cry anymore. And you can't have tests that are that long. We had a long history of testing in New York State with much shorter tests. And as long as you don't have high stakes consequences on them, it's kind of okay. A lot of the reasons why those tests were lengthened because they knew they were going to evaluate teachers by test scores and they had to be able to measure the the tails better. They had to be able to look at the growth. They had to withstand challenges in the courts. The one challenge, they didn't do so well, thanks in great part to my friend over here, who gave some expert testimony that he wrote. But you know, you can have shorter, more reasonable tests that give parents, give schools, give communities an idea of how kids are doing without being crazy. And I think what's even more important is just the removal of those high stakes. Because as long as those high stakes are on the tests, parents are never going to feel as though it's about their kid. They're going to feel that it's about something else. But anyway, that's the history of opt-out, at least as this one person who was kind of a rabble-rouser in the whole movement views it. Thanks.
So I have two questions that I want to pose to the panel before turning us loose to our audience's questions. And they both have to do with trends over time, and perhaps they're related. We saw some evidence of changes over time in Eric's and Julie's account, and Carol has suggested that there may be changes in terms of a lack of momentum with changes in the features of the test. New York State in 2016 made the tests untimed and slightly shorter in terms of the number of items, but untimed tests can still result in kids taking long hours to complete them. And the removal of high stakes still holds for the time being with regard to the use of the state's grades 3 through 8 tests for the evaluation of teachers and for promotion decisions, but as Julie noted, it's still the case that parents are concerned about the use of the tests for access to competitive placements in middle schools. So what changes do we see happening over time and what are the consequences? There's one other thing that I'm curious about, and that is, you know, Carol made reference to former State Commissioner John King, and clearly there was a time when there were efforts on the part of the state to basically threaten schools and parents. And I'm wondering whether that evoked a backlash causing teachers and parents to redouble their efforts to resist in the face of the indignation at being threatened about the consequences for things that they had a very serious personal stake in with regard to the children they were either teaching or their own kids. So that's one question about those trends. And then the broader question, the sort of the group therapy question is, we have a new administration in Washington. What might we expect to see with regard to opting out in the face of the policies that are likely to emerge from the new, I still have trouble saying it, Trump-DeVos administration? So we'll start with those two questions to our panel and then perhaps move to some questions from the audience.
I'll start with just a short comment on the question of the threats and whether that had a particular impact. I will note for those of you who are following the news that just yesterday, Eva Moskowitz made the announcement that no Achievement First, is that Success Academy, schools, students would be allowed to opt out of the tests, and that they would prevent that happening in their schools, which is just very interesting to note that that threat has just resurfaced in a particular charter sector. But I do remember when that happened for our school, that we, in some ways, doubled down as a school. When you have those discourses of threats going on, but you also have other discourses like opt out that your school can connect to. I think as teachers, if you feel like you're in a reasonably safe environment, that there are people with credibility that are out there that are making these moves, and in our case, that we felt very protected as a reasonably successful school with progressive administrators, it makes a very big difference in how these kinds of things feel school to school. And I know I have had colleagues that took those threats a lot more seriously and said, well, in our school, we're worried about this, this, and this, which are things that my teachers were less concerned with. So just note that once again, that context seems to play out very differently. And I think right now, for those teachers that are teaching in Success Academy, that threat is probably going to have it's going to be interesting to watch how that plays out among both staff as well as parents and students.
But keeping in mind that New York City opting out has, percentage-wise, been quite low. I mean, we typically see 2 to 3% of students in the city not taking the state tests in the traditional public sector. So it is remarkable how it's sort of geographically dispersed across New York State.
Yeah, I just,
you know, there, in terms of the threats, the threats stopped from the chancellor. So even through last spring, colleagues of mine were being, you know, pointed to at public meetings and encouraged to discourage the parents from opting out. And people were concerned about, you know, what that meant for the safety of their schools and their jobs. And in terms of doubling down, it did mean that those of us who are tenured, who feel like we have stronger schools, it is then our obligation to stand up for other folks who are not in such strong positions. In terms of what this current administration will develop in terms of policy, they don't even seem to be able to spell the word policy, and I don't know, you know, they haven't been able to put anything together, so we'll deal with that when it comes.
Tone has changed, and tone has changed in Albany. Both John King and Merrill Tisch leaving has made a big difference. Betty Rosa being the new chancellor has made a big difference. I actually thought that opt-out was going to drop more this year because people just don't feel that sense of, I mean, we were just angry all of the time. Of course, I retired too, so I'm not as much in the loop as I used to be. But there still is, you know, and until they get to the point where they change the tests, where they're willing to change the tests substantially, I think it's going to continue. There may not be as much anger directed at certain individuals as there was before, but anger at the tests, yes. Betsy DeVos, I spend most of my time not as much worried about opt-out and testing these days as I do about the continuance of public education in this country. You're not going to see her push testing. And I'll tell you why. Because if you look at any of the studies, for example, on charter schools, what you find, and we've had them now for 2 decades, that they do no better than public schools, and in many cases do worse. And there have been several very, very interesting studies that have come out around the country on the long-term voucher programs, and the evidence is very clear in those studies, and especially the good studies that are not done by think tanks but are actually done by researchers, that kids that move out of a public school and into a school with their voucher do worse. So testing, in some ways, bringing that out is problematic. And as I watch some of the people who are very much involved in the choice movement, which is really a rebranding of the movement that was started by Milton Friedman around vouchers and some other things, you see them saying, well, it's all about parents voting with their feet. You know, the scores aren't really all that important. There was a whole editorial that was done by Fordham the other day that said that. And I was like, what? You know, before they were everything. So when you hear Betsy DeVos talking about testing, she doesn't talk about NAEP. She wouldn't talk about NAEP because the truth of the matter is NAEP scores have been kind of, you know, they've been kind of going up. They took a little slip because of the Common Core. So it's always the TIM stuff, right? The vague, we're in the middle of the pack. Well, we've always been in the middle of the pack. And, you know, and my worry, I'm almost worried about testing going away altogether. And I know that sounds crazy coming out of my mouth, but if there is not a measure of some kind to show
that a lot of the charter schools are absolutely horrible. They're for profit. And to show that vouchers are not working, then what are we going to have? This is without a doubt a movement that really is coming from not even so much conservatives, because there's nothing conservative about wanting to rip down the public institution of public education. It's really almost more of a libertarian strain, with the idea of, you know, it's dog eat dog, and you just go with your feet, and if your kid does great and you pick a good school, well, yippee. And you know what? If the parent doesn't speak English and they can't find the good school and they make a bad choice, well, that's life. I went yesterday to investors in the charter school sector, and I kind of sat in the back, and they were all the money people. And I raised my hand at the end and, you know, asked a couple of questions. And the guy didn't really know where I was coming from. And what he said to me is, he said, well, you know, I'm a Darwinian guy. You know, I kind of believe in Darwin, and I believe in the marketplace. That is the kind of thinking that is happening right now. So I don't think you're going to see a lot of stuff with high-stakes tests, because if it's not a bat that can be used against democratically controlled public education, then it's not going to be an instrument that I think that the present administration is going to be interested in.
I know we have a question here.
Yeah, I wanted to say, this doctor, with the testing in kindergarten, was this testing before they started kindergarten to see if they were ready for it, or after they had spent about a year in kindergarten?
No, it was supposed to be given the October that they arrived in kindergarten.
Yeah, we have that crazy system in Baltimore. They had to answer questions, and one day this little boy told the teacher, "Lady, you're a fool. I'm coming to you."
Teach me. Yeah, right. And testing gets in the way of real learning.
Oh, yes, sir. Ask them. They don't give them that. You say six numbers. What is this? What is this? And most of these kids were what you call eligible for free lunch. So you can imagine what kind of environment they come in. So the little boy walked out. He said, "That's a crazy teacher. She hasn't taught me."
Thank you.
The information that you presented this afternoon is like overwhelming. Yeah. I am, thank God, a retired administrator. And I'm very familiar with the process. And every one of you said something that almost like hit me in the stomach. And I'll talk to you individually, because hearing about the K students being tested, there is more pressure put on with parents putting on their kindergarten students to get into these design schools where they are tracked from the day they get into kindergarten into the track to the university that they're going to get into. And I don't hear any disturbance about that. But back to the first panel, and I really appreciate you pointing out that 82% of the survey reported that they didn't want their students, the STEM, to be evaluated with the standardized
the teacher evaluation. They didn't want standardized tests to be used for teacher evaluation.
They didn't want that to be a criteria. But my question is that, and I'm happy to see that in New York City that there are less parents opting out, because the majority of the students in New York City public schools are people of color, and the 85% of those teachers in there standing in front of them who send their kids to college off of the backs of the ones that they teach every day, those people, those teachers need to have some type of a criteria to see why they can get all the way to a pension and retirement, and then these kids that they're standing in front of every day, they can't get to the next grade. And those people look like me, and those teachers who are teaching look like you. So in many regards, something has to be done, something has to be said for those white teachers standing up in front of those students of color and not providing them with the wherewithal to get to where they need to be. And yet these teachers can go straight through the system to retirement. None of them came through me. And I know that teachers will work if you are a leader and you tell them, as I did. How many of you are parents? How many of you have students in college? How many of you have students out of college? Unless you are prepared to do the same thing for the children in this classroom that you do for the ones at home, then you need to decide, do I need to send you a letter to go to some other place? And my students, my students excel and my teachers perform. It's a leadership problem.
Well, I think you're right that the most important features of teacher professional development are not going to come from test scores. They're going to come from school-based leadership and the capacity to organize teachers in ways that can make them more effective. And research that I'm doing right now, looking at how teachers in New York City are experiencing the teacher evaluation system, is making it very clear that teachers are very, very skeptical of those components of their evaluation system that are based on standardized tests. If you don't trust the test, there's no reason to think it's going to have any way to inform what represents better practice.
Yeah, so I'm going to play the devil's advocate a little bit, just because I work with students in high school where they sort of have to take the Regents, right? You can't opt out or you can't graduate. So I was wondering if there's any sort of data that looks at how opting out in middle school might affect students' performance on Regents in high school.
I mean, I'd love to talk about that from just my own experiences as a high school principal for 15 years. I never encouraged kids to opt out of a Regents exam, and it wasn't even the matter that they do need to pass the five in order to be able to graduate. I think they're pretty good exams. I mean, they're the new ones with the Common Core, not so much the English and the math, but for many years, the Regents exams that I took as a when I was in high school, so you know we're going back for a very long time, all the way through to the ones that our daughters took, to the ones now, they're teacher-created exams, and they're based on a curriculum, and they're not extraordinarily long for the kids of that age group, right? So I was very curious as a principal, because Rockville Center, where I was a huge area of opt-out. We, you know, big numbers from the beginning. And I know that one of our assistant superintendents was very concerned, because they said, you know, we're worried, Carol, that what's going to wind up happening is the kids opt out in the middle school, then they're going to come to you and they're going to say, well, I don't want to take that Regents exam, or I don't want to take this or a teacher test. Did not happen. Not only did it not happen, there was no change in scores. None at all. So the relationship between middle school, and I looked at it really carefully over the course of probably a good 3 years. There just was no relationship at all. No negative effects.
Can I just make a comment about that? So in the survey that we did, respondents had kids from pre-K or younger, they were just parents of toddlers up through grade 12. So we didn't address what you're asking specifically, but we did have several spots in the survey for open-ended questions. So if you remember, I mentioned there were about 20% of respondents that were parents of school-age public school children who were participants in the movement, but sort of didn't opt out. And when we looked at some of their open-ended answers to some of the questions, they were talking about, A, they weren't sure if there was going to be any sanction or any punishment if they opted out, because that message was very unclear from state authorities. And also, they knew, if they were parents of younger kids, that eventually, that they were part of a standardized testing culture regardless, and that there may be a state requirement to have to take a high stakes test to graduate or whatnot. And so some of those parents were commenting on something to the effect of, I don't like it, it's sort of a bitter pill to swallow, but I feel like my kid is in this system, it's part of the system, and they need to be able to take these kinds of tests. So I oppose it, but my kids are gonna sit for the test anyway.
Question. I'm just wondering how you square away the kind of the mantra of teachers make a difference when the 83% of the parents or people say we don't want that to be tested to be part of the assessment of the teacher, and you keep saying, and the constant comment is the teachers make a difference. How do you know that?
I think you're making the assumption that before all of this, principals didn't take a look at how kids were doing, at who was passing the class, at what the disciplinary referral rate was, how the kids did on the Regents exam, for example. My school was very invested in the International Baccalaureate. So of course I always took a look at teachers, and I tried to look at trends over time. So if I saw that there was one year where the kids didn't do that well, and I looked at the kids in the class, okay, you know, when that became a trend of 2 or 3 or 4 years, then I knew something was up. And then I would try to figure out what it was and then go in with some professional development or some targeted, maybe some targeted observations. But the idea of putting the score in the teacher's evaluation system, there was a huge rebellion by the New York State principals against it. Now, my school believed that every kid should have access to International Baccalaureate courses. In fact, we got to a point where we gave everybody IB. And the last thing I ever wanted was for a teacher to look at that class, we talk about equity, and say, oh, I don't want that kid in that class. Their score is going to affect my evaluation. And that little girl over there, she doesn't show up very often. That boy, he has an anxiety disorder. So the whole thing that concerned me as a principal was I was building this system based on equity and access to really good enriched learning, wanting teachers to take a chance with all kids. And then the worry became how, if I knew my job was dependent upon a test score of kids that I really can't control everything, what was that going to do to the relationship between teachers and kids? That was what concerned me the most. Wasn't that I never took a look at how the kids in the class were doing academically. I always did. But to have it built into a teacher evaluation system that for the first time was saying you can get fired made no sense. There's also, as a researcher I knew from her, there was no validity and reliability to it. It was a crapshoot. I mean, especially with Regents exams, we had to use them and try to come up with a formula. And I tried so hard to see if I could actually find some kind of a correlation with teachers and scores. And I mean, no matter how often I did it, I couldn't come up with it. So it's a bogus measure, and then you're sticking it in the middle. And my greatest worry was that rather than making my high school a more equitable place, it was an integrated high school that had really wealthy kids as well as kids on free or reduced price lunch, that all of those equity issues were going to go down the tubes because the teachers would look at the kids in the class and almost start to see some of them as a threat to their job.
Yeah. And that's okay. Then they would perform.
Well, my teachers performed very well without that.
So the time has actually flown by, which means we have one more question.
So I'm not sure how to phrase this, but I just started to hear it, and I heard a little bit with Ms. Zuckerman. The population of children with IEPs, so what happens for them in regards to this? Because if we know what's happening on the impartial hearing process, that my children are recipients of, I had to opt them out of public school, and one child was forced back in, but the other one was able to leave public school and receive a full non-public private education, a graduate of Adelphi University. Okay, I'm working very well at the moment. The experience was different with testing. When you are in the public school IEP set up that is what they call non-public school. Okay. The student may have to take one Regents exam. That's it. They're not doing any of this. They're taking usually an English Regent. So City as School would be another example of that as an alternative school, which is where my other, my one son that had to maintain public school education after a while, graduated. My other son never had to take a region and only had to take the SAT, and so we worked with the SAT. So it was totally focused on college and career readiness, and it wasn't about anything else. Now, did the schools have their own measures? Of course they did. They had their own kind of assessment process that started in the beginning of each semester and measured the amount of growth in various areas for each of the children, and then adjusted the curriculum accordingly. So what I'm wondering is, like, I hear the overall concern, but I also know the pressure that it puts on students and how it starts to eliminate access. If my older son had to go through, because of knowing his anxiety, I don't believe he would be where he is today. My younger son is almost in a test with that because of what happens in the public school system from grade to grade and so on and so forth, that is extremely uneven, very biased on many accounts, that there's a huge struggle there for students who will not move on as citizens in a certain kind of pace and deal with self-esteem issues that we've heard in other lectures today. So I'm just curious, you know, just to what I said, what did you say to what I'm saying? And how will this affect so many of the students who have IEPs and then those that are undiagnosed?
So I can just share with you what we found in the survey data. Again, we didn't specifically ask respondents, do any of your children have IEPs? But in the open-ended responses, we had, hundreds of responses saying specifically, I have a kid on an IEP and there's absolutely no way I would ever have them sit for this. And that was a very common refrain.
And I just feel that certainly there are testing modifications that are written into IEPs so that the situation can be more accommodating of the student, and changes in promotional criteria. I'm familiar with City as School, and there. Certainly within the smaller schools, there is plenty of opportunity to have authentic assessment that is very rigorous and has high standards and shows tremendous capacity in the children. And that's really all you wanted to see, is that kids can think and apply the skills, the habits, the information that they have. And sometimes the test will show that, and sometimes the test will not, but you can find out about that without having test scores. And if that works for a school, if that works for a family, you know, so be it. We have plenty of kids who, and families who will throw a lot of effort into alternative kinds of assessment, and then the kids are happy to go off to schools that are heavy testing schools, and they're, you know, they do it later. It's okay. They're not scared about it. It's not about being scared of the test. It's about thinking that there are other opportunities or other ways of showing your capacities.
Please join me in thanking the panel for their expertise.